This photo was taken by one of our RFID subject matter experts. You'll notice the RFID reader, antenna, and UPS are all held in place using duct tape. This is a perfect example of how not to install an RFID system. Hi, I'm Lou Sirico, and in this edition of the RFID Network, we're going to take a look at RFID system installation best practices. Stay tuned. Welcome to the RFID Network. I'm your host, Lou Sirico. In this edition, we're going to take a look at RFID system installation best practices. And with me is Joe Leone. Joe, welcome to the RFID Network.
Thanks for having me in today, Lou.
It's great to have you here. So Joe, tell us, you saw that lovely freestanding RFID read point. If you were going to implement an RFID read point such as that one, what would you do? What are some of the things you look for?
Well, there's a lot to be said for field expediency, and we'll give them an A for effort. But what you really want to do is you want to look for a professionally designed and engineered piece of gear, something like we've got standing in front of us here. There's some key components that you want to look for, adjustable brackets. You've got your indicators, your light indicators, good antenna positioning and placement capabilities, good solid base so that you can secure it down. It's not going to get knocked over by somebody bumping into it or something running into it. From the standpoint of fabrication and manufacturing, again, professional look, professional design, and what I would consider to be simplicity of installation. And we see that here. We've got a NEMA enclosure. Swing this open. It's a good NEMA-rated enclosure so we can get all of our electronics in here, all of our antenna cabling. We can run it down and connect up to our reader inside. Got good power connectivity. Everything seals up real nice. This is a perfect unit to provide you with the same functionality that we saw in the coat rack unit that you just showed us.
So if I had a conveyance system, that would be a little bit different than this. How would we do that?
Yes, that's got its own unique set of challenges, and we probably should go look at a conveyor system, and I'll take you through some of those.
Excellent. All right. Well, let's go take a look.
All right.
Using the mix-and-match component system from Jamison RFID that Joe talks about, the coat rack installation was greatly improved upon. The reader and the UPS are now safely housed in a protective NEMA-rated enclosure. Using a pole, connectors, floor mount, and brackets, the antennas are placed at the optimal locations for the best possible tag read performance. All of the components assemble and install quickly and provide both a sturdy and professional solution.
So Joe, tell us, what are some of the things we should look for when installing RFID on a conveyor?
Lou, there's a number of things that need to be analyzed and evaluated when you're installing RFID around conveyor systems. First and foremost, you need to understand your environment. Are you working with metal conveyors? Are you working with canvas or rubber conveyors? Can you mount directly to the frame, or do you need to go freestanding on the side? How do the antennas need to be placed, over or below? So there's a number of things that need to be looked at when you first design the system. What we have here is a good solid metal conveyor system. This very industrial setup allows us to mount directly to the conveyor. We have to understand how the RF field is going to be impacted by the rollers and the roller rods. If we were going to go to a freestanding type of an installation, we've got some great adapter rods here that allow us to take this and mount it actually freestanding right around the conveyor without actually touching or impacting the conveyor. This gives them flexibility to move it. If the conveyor moves back and forth, if they have to adjust it, it keeps the RFID system in place without them having to worry about touching that. When we look at different aspects of adjusting antennas, they've got a great bracket here which allows us to not only quickly mount and with toolless adjustments, but they've actually got laser etched 15 degree hash marks that when aligned properly give us both azimuth and elevation measurement marks and allow us to easily adjust and tune our antennas that way as well. So they've even got some good measuring tools built right into the brackets. Again, good foresight, good engineering. When you're installing antennas underneath the conveyor or underneath what might be a rubber conveyor, there's one gotcha that you need to be aware of. In many cases, you're working with plastic or high-density polyethylene that goes underneath that conveyor mat. And what will happen is that will begin to build up a static charge. You've got to ensure that your gear, that the conveyor, and especially your reader is grounded, because that charge will look to discharge over a period of time. And I've actually been in situations where we've blown readers because we were told that the gear was grounded, that the actual conveyor was grounded, and found that it wasn't grounded well enough. And what we wound up doing was actually monitoring the system, and we actually have pictures of the arc jumping across from the reader to the conveyor. So wow. It's, again, things that just you're not aware of. Those gotchas you got
to
be careful of.
Something to think about before installing RFID at a conveyor. Well, excellent. Thank you, Joe. So portals, that's obviously another place RFID technology is used extensively. Can we go take a look at an example of how to install portals, RFID at a portal properly?
Sure. Let's take a look.
Excellent. Let's go take a look. So here we are at one of the dock doors in our warehouse facility. So Joe, tell us, what are some of the best practices when RFID enabling a dock door?
So Lou, companies have done a great job of packaging up antennas, readers, power supplies, and so forth into very nice, easy to install packages. However, there's still a number of things that need to be considered before you just go start installing equipment. So let's take a look at a couple of them. First of all, proper portal placement is critical to getting accurate data. But there are a couple of things you have to be cognizant and aware of. Number one is the drive path. So where is freight going to flow? How is it going to flow past them perpendicular to your portals? Two is how will forklifts actually approach the portals when they come in. It's very important to understand from a safety perspective, so the portal is getting best data capture accuracy, but also there's some longevity and you're not going to keep hitting portals with forklifts or forklifts with portals. Other things to consider, how you're going to run your power and your data connections. A lot of folks, when they do this, they have a tendency to want to run them down on the floor, but you have to understand your environment. From an environmental perspective, if you're going to get any water pooling, and you may not think that happens, but in rainstorm, if it's raining sideways, and I've seen it happen, water will come in and it'll hit those portals, start to pool up. You want to be cognizant and aware of that. So you want to make sure that your conduits run into the top of the portals in most cases. That gives you the best, the safest way of connecting data and power to your readers in the portals themselves. And when it comes to portal placement again is going to be crucial. Too far apart, you may wind up with not getting the reads that you want. Too close to the door, you may wind up reading pallets in the door, and that may be false reads that you're getting if you don't, if you don't need to have those reads. If your software is not filtering that data, then you're going to be reading stuff inside the truck when you don't want to. So these are all things you need to be aware of from a portal placement perspective.
So positioning of the antenna is absolutely critical in a configuration like that.
Absolutely. The nice thing about some of the gear that we have here is that they give you the ability to articulate the antenna. Okay, nice articulation arms in there that give you both horizontal and vertical tuning capabilities. A couple of other things I'd like to point out is that they have built-in power source for any of your digital I.O., like lights, openers, sensors, and so forth, all built in. They have some additional receptacles, and they also have power switches so that you can turn these on and off individually. And in many of the military installations, that's becoming a mandatory requirement. They also have your standard motion sensor and visual indicators on the outside. And everything's in a nice industrial form. And back here we have the cover. We've taken those off to show you the antennas. But back here we also have those covers that'll go on the outside and give that a nice clean finish look, even in an industrial form.
Excellent. And obviously, in this particular situation, we've got a bollard right in front of the antenna. How's this work?
Well, we put this this way, Lou, so we could show you the way not to do this. Because while this looks like we're doing a great job protecting the portal, the problem that we're doing is we're actually introducing an inordinate amount of metal in front of these antennas, and then there's a lot of flux in the field, and we're introducing nulls. So our read pattern is very unpredictable here and probably not very good.
So another example of what not to do.
What not to do here. This was, again, we've seen this happen. Folks will install these portals and just drop this in front, not realizing, because the covers are on them, that they can't interfere with the actual energy pattern or the antenna pattern that's being generated with metal objects. How you want to do that is the way we have it here. You take two of these and you strategically place them based, again, on your drive path, freight flow, and so forth, so that if something were to come around too sharply and clip this, they're going to take the bollard out first and save this expensive piece of gear compared to the cost of the bollard and hopefully give it a little more life. Okay.
Now, what about the components inside there? You know, some of the things that we've seen, you know, dirt and rain, you mentioned rain and snow. So ventilation versus no ventilation, what's your thoughts on that?
That's a good question. There's differing opinions on ventilated and not ventilated portals. What I'd say is this. Again, having to do mostly with understanding your environment, how much water you're going to get in and around those portals, to me, is going to be the biggest factor. You don't want to have water accumulating or standing inside those portals for the sheer fact there's electrical gear down there. If that is the case, then you want to be careful. Okay. Other than that, it's good for heat disbursement. You've got a lot of gear in there. A lot of this gear generates heat, and so the ability to get that heat out of there, right, to ventilate it out, is kind of critical. So again, if you're in areas where it's very cold, not a big deal. If you're in areas where it's very hot, it could be a very big deal. So again, environmental issues are going to dictate the way to go.
So understanding the environmental conditions, the read zone configuration, the traffic flow in and out of the dock door, all of these are really, really important considerations. So for people out there looking to do this, they really should consult an expert before they just go pick up some of this equipment and say, hey, let's put it in this door.
Absolutely. I 100% recommend and would implore people to get somebody involved who's done this before. While it may seem simplistic, okay, there's a lot of things that can go wrong, and it can dramatically affect the success of your solution. So having this planned out ahead of time by a professional, as long as it's at least from a consultative perspective, will help get you on the right path. To just go out and buy a bunch of gear and start installing it, I'd say you're just wasting your money.
Joe, thank you so much for all of that excellent advice.
Lou, it's been a pleasure being here.
Great to have you.
Thank you.
If you'd like more information about installing RFID systems in portals, conveyors, or in freestanding locations, we invite you to watch the video series, Installing RFID Systems Successfully by Jamison RFID. There's a link next to this video.
That wraps it up for this edition of the RFID Network. If you'd like more information on the products you've seen, please visit us on the web at rfid.net. Thanks for watching.